So, that's it. I'm going to get straight into it and introduce our wonderful panel. At the far end, we have Jacob Varghese. He's the Class Actions and Social Justice Principal from Maurice Blackburn. And that's a firm that's fought a number of very high-profile cases on behalf of refugees, including one I think you might remember. It led to over 100 babies born in detention being released with their families into the community back in 2014. So welcome, Jacob.
Thank you.
And I'm going to give you a clap. Next to Jacob is Dr. Soulette Dreyfus. Soulette is a researcher at Melbourne University. She's widely published articles and books about security in the digital era. And some of you might know her from her book and articles called Underground, which was researched by Julian Assange. And that book was published in 1997, was it? But it's still considered a seminal work, and I understand there's a documentary and a movie, but maybe less said about the movie, perhaps. So welcome, Soulette.
Thank you.
And right next to me here is Roderick St. George. Roderick is a former occupational health and safety manager, among other roles. He was at the Manus Island Detention Centre in Papua New Guinea. And in 2013, Roderick described the facility as not fit for a dog kennel. And he had some shocking allegations of rape, torture in the centre. Now, he whistleblew despite knowing he'd face prosecution and even jail. So a very big welcome to Roderick, who in this public interest and in front of a large crowd is willing to revisit what was and probably remains still a traumatising experience. So welcome, Roderick. And Roderick, on that, yesterday, big news, I don't know, you probably all know this because you're an intelligent audience, all the audiences that come to the Wheeler Centre are, but the PNG Supreme Court ruled that the Manus Island Detention Centre breached the human right to liberty and was therefore illegal. So I imagine that this is a significant decision for you, Roderick.
I was pushing for that several years ago. Obviously thought it was way out of my league, but the Papua New Guinea government, opposition anyway, has there's been a lot of disquiet over the years about the centre itself and all that stands for, imprisonment even of convicted criminals in Papua New Guinea is considered abhorrent. So, to imprison innocent people really goes beyond the pale as far as the New Guinea people are concerned, especially the Manutians, who are by and large very peaceful people. So, I think this is a good sign. There's a touch of irony in it, of course. I think Australia has been lecturing Papua New Guinea for many years, decades, on how to come into the civilised world and to improve their moral standing in the world. And here, Papua New Guinea has sort of given Australia a straight arm warning and said, this is unethical, we're not going to put up with it. So, yeah, quite ironic.
So in 2013, that's over 3 years ago now, isn't it? You saw some things at the Manus Island detention. Can you just briefly outline what led you to blow the whistle on what was going on there?
Look, it's almost impossible to say it briefly, but
I understand that.
I suppose if you could, consider what it would be like walking out here onto the main street and seeing a child hit by a tram and wanting to help them, but then being surrounded by police to tell you can't, that it's illegal. That's a kind of situation that we were facing, the NGOs, that is, on Manus every day. There was one 8-year-old boy that went to his mum and asked which direction he had to cut his arm to make it bleed the most. I can't even imagine as a parent what that would be like. But we put the health and wellbeing of people ahead of the department's policies.
But you weren't allowed to, which is what led you to whistleblowing.
Yeah, definitely. And it caused a lot of frustration and angst, I think, for the department. Ultimately, it was because of the suffering of the people and the unwillingness of the department to budge on their policy. Once you went to Manus, you stayed there.
And I suppose we've yet to see what's going to be the outcome of this Manus Island decision from the Supreme Court. There's a lot of political argy-bargy going on. There'll be some legal cases in the offing. Jacob, you've and your team run a number of cases, and your current case, I understand, involves a class action for detainees at Christmas Island. Can you describe your lead client, AS? What's AS? Who is she?
AS is a 8-year-old girl who spent 2 years of her life in detention on Christmas Island. Her family came to Australia shortly after the government had announced the change in policy that no one under any circumstances would come here just before the last election. And she was with her mother and father. Her mother was pregnant at the time. And where the case is focusing on the treatment that she received and the damage that's been done to her both developmentally and psychologically, but also as a representative of an entire class of people who went through Christmas Island. With Christmas Island, it is a bit different to Manus and Nauru in the sense that it's a part of Australia. It sometimes doesn't feel like it, and it's certainly a long way from the mainland, but it is controlled by Australian law. So we have options there that are a bit more open for accessing rights to compensation and a review of the treatment that people receive there. But that's what the class action's about. It's really focusing on the level of care people received in detention, not necessarily the fact of detention, which is unfortunately the law of the land, but the care that people receive there, especially with respect to their mental health.
And so would it be fair to say that in many of the cases that you have mounted on behalf of asylum seekers, have relied a lot on whistleblowers?
It's interesting because the truth is it's very risky for a lawyer running a case to talk to a whistleblower because there's some precedent that the lawyers can be kicked off the case, which is not good for the plaintiff, not good for anyone. If you talk to a whistleblower who divulges confidential information that they weren't allowed to divulge. In the Christmas Island class action, in order to avoid that, we've had lots of whistleblowers, a couple of dozen whistleblowers say they want to help us, and we've proactively approached the judge for assistance.
You've gone to make orders.
So the judge made an order, for example, a very curious order, that under the Border Force Act, someone can speak... notwithstanding the Border Force Act, if the court orders them to do so. So the court made a curious order in which the court ordered anyone who wants to speak to Maurice Blackburn to speak to Maurice Blackburn effectively. They had to voluntarily agree to be ordered, but then that was a way of getting around the Border Force Act. It didn't really deal with the Crimes Act or common law obligations people might have, and so we're still working through that. But we hope to rely on those whistleblowers. But at this stage, we're going on with the expectation whether we can or can't will depend on whether we can navigate that channel.
Well, that's very interesting because you're actually having to navigate two sets of acts, the Crimes Act and the Border Force Act. Let's just strip those two down. First of all, the Crimes Act. We've heard a lot in recent times of the Border Force Act, which was passed last year and it attracts 2 years jail. But in fact, the Crimes Act has always attracted 2 years jail for over 100 years, hasn't it?
Yeah, I'm not sure whether that provision's... It's certainly generations old, I think.
1914.
Yeah, the Border Force Act has gotten a lot of attention, but the truth is any Commonwealth servant or agent, which can include a third-party
contractor... And that means contractors...
Yep. can be imprisoned for 2 years for divulging any information that they are under a duty not to disclose. And that duty could be created by way of the Public Service Act or the Public Service Code of Conduct or a private contract between the government and the contractor. It's probably, I think, probably the most breached law in Australia, certainly in the ACT. And when you have a law that's been, it's breached by every public servant who goes home and tells their spouse what they did at work today, potentially. And when you have a law that is breached so often, when it gets enforced, you have to be concerned about politically motivated selective enforcement. And it's in fact very, very rarely been enforced. It was, it was recently used under the by the AFP to investigate Save the Children whistleblowers in
Nauru.
Yes,
tell us about the Save the Children, because this is quite a, in a sense, a fun story in the end, isn't it?
Well, yeah, I'm not sure the people who experienced it think of it
that
way.
No, but I mean the result. Because
that's right. Well, yeah. Save the Children was participating in the Nauru operations to look after the welfare of people in detention, and many of their staff blew the whistle by talking to journalists and others about what they had witnessed there, including allegations of sexual abuse and other abuse of children. And when that reached the newspapers, the minister, who I think was Scott Morrison at the time, accused them of making it up and accused them of agitating protests and other things on Nauru, and got the AFP set onto them to investigate whether they'd breached the Crimes Act by talking to the press. So they all found themselves being dealt with pretty heavy-handed manner. Ultimately, the government sent a person out there, Mr. Moss, to conduct a review of what happened, and he found that the allegations they made were substantiated. And in fact, in the end, the AFP didn't take its investigation against the Save the Children employees anywhere. Mm. There was a political beat up by the minister there, accusing them of fabricating the stuff and doing so for political purposes, when in fact the truth was, as we now know, there has been serious problems with the abuse of people on Nauru, including sexual abuse of children.
And that's been borne out by their own department's reports.
That's right.
Recent reports, I think there was something like 55 on Nauru in year 2014 or 2015, that's right, to September 15. Sulet, it's been 23 years, which is the age of my youngest daughter, when the introduction of mandatory detention by the then Prime Minister Paul Keating. And seriously, from the beginning, there was a wall of secrecy around mandatory detention. I'm old enough to remember that journalists and NGOs had very restricted access to the Australian detention centres, Port Hedland, the Woomera Detention Centre, for example. But Sulet, as a researcher in whistleblowing, you say now it's even worse. You say the wall has got 10 feet higher.
Well, I do think that to some degree. The fact is that, I don't think there were that many people who were happy about it then. But I think that the public's appetite and willingness to accept secrecy from its large institutions is a bit different. And there's a lot less tolerance because more wrongdoing has come out in thanks to whistleblowers. So some research, I've been involved in researching whistleblowing, including the technological impacts on it, since 2010. And one bit of research, a project I've been involved with, has looked at public attitudes in Australia to whistleblowing.
Oh, we like a whistleblower, don't we?
Well,
we can delineate between a dobber and a whistleblower.
Absolutely. There seems to be no doubt in Australians' minds about the difference between someone who dibby-dobs and someone who whistleblows in the public interest about serious wrongdoing. What was interesting that came out of that research is half of Australians, 50% of them, think there is too much secrecy in organisations in this society. That's a very high number. But even higher are the numbers that say, well, look, should a whistleblower be punished for revealing information, secret information, inside their organization, or should they be supported? Well, 81% of Australians think that they should be supported, not punished.
That's a really high figure.
A huge figure. Mm. And in fact, when we asked, well, should they be allowed to go to the media to reveal this wrongdoing, first instance, last resort, in a range of scenarios, 87% of Australians said yes. So what we see is this kind of enormous disjoint between what the public attitudes, what the mores of the time are about whistleblowers, and what the law has been made to, you know, to allow in Australia, and what government implementation of that law has been. And this trend is not just Australia. I mean, we look at it and we see it particularly with regard to detention centres. It's happening with the healthcare system in the UK. It's happening in the financial services sector in the US.
And in the US, and in Australia.
And in Australia. It's happening across a whole range of sectors and different countries. And the same survey results we had done with colleagues of ours in the UK were very similar results about concerns. In fact, they were even higher for concerns around too much secrecy, needing to support whistleblowers, and higher still in places like Iceland. We're kind of targeting all the island nations. But that sort of illustrates that this is not just something unique to Australia. It's like little bushfires that are popping up around the world, around a bunch of different sectors. And so I think this is an ethical temperature taking.
You actually see whistleblowing as a yes. temperature. So what's the gauge saying? I mean, are you saying that there's more whistleblowers because there's more secrecy?
Well, I think technology has played a significant role in it. There's no doubt about that. And that's partially the advent of big data being able to be analyzed very easily with technology and telling a fact-based story that is undeniable. So whether that's about whether, you know, the public has been told a lie about a war that may not be going as well as we were told it was, or a set of other things, that's part of it. Also, technology allows anonymity much more easily. But it also allows tracking of whistleblowers talking to journalists much more easily, so it's a double-edged sword. Mm. But in general, I'd say there is a kind of a movement, and that movement is around people being willing to step forward and say, I see wrongdoing, I'm not going to be silent about it. And, you know, it's interesting, I had a conversation with Daniel Ellsberg of the Pentagon Papers, an extraordinary man. The kind of first well-known whistleblower in our modern history. And he said to me, the thing about a whistleblower is you'll have a row of 10 people, in rows of desks and 10 people in office. What you just want is that one person who has got an ethical center, who can look over his desk, out the window, to the street below, and see how the things that he is doing, the wrongdoing he might be asked to do, is going to affect all of those people walking down that street.
Well, this is what Roderick, clearly that's what happened to him. He took that step. Mm-hmm. How was that for you, Roderick? I mean, what were the fears that you had about disclosing this information? I mean, you did face prosecution.
Yeah,
I knew that. You'd signed a confidentiality agreement.
I did. I wrestled with it. I'd worked 10 years in the prison industry, so I knew it wasn't a place that I wanted to live in. And as an ex-prison guard, even less so. But
you went into that business because you thought you wanted to help people, didn't you?
Yeah. And I think I did. I think my concerns were laid by a meeting with Julian Burnside.
The well-known lawyer who's most likely here tonight.
At which point we should all stand up and just... he's my hero in all of this, really. I think he's a wonderful
so
example.
So what was his advice to you?
He looked at the deed of confidentiality, especially those parts that referred to the Crimes Act. And he said confidently, well, they can't send you to prison, but I can't say that the company you work for won't make your life hell for the next few years.
Now, you resigned before...
I had resigned before that.
Was
yeah.
that was a conscious decision?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
And Jacob,
yeah.
would that be yeah. the wise thing to do?
Oh, well, look, it depends on everyone's individual circumstances. I mean, if people need their job to keep paying for their mortgage and whatever else, they might not be in the position to take that step, in which case they need to find another way through.
Mm. I just wonder, though, we're talking about whistleblowers. There's an increase in whistleblowers because of there's this sort of a culture of secrecy, essentially. But there is there also a language around what's going on in terms of our asylum seeker policy? I mean, we have politicians and prime ministers saying this is a war against people smugglers. Mm. We have Operation Sovereign Borders, Minister for Immigration and Border Protection, Border Force workers. Is the language part of creating a fear around disclosure because it's a militarised sort of language? Any of you comment on that?
Well, I know within days after the Abbott government came in, there was an email that went out from the Chief of Defence Force staff forbidding that any vessel out in the Indian Ocean or up in the Northern Waters was to be identified. Mm. There was this cloak of secrecy over it. And then, of course, if you listen to Scott Morrison as he fronted the cameras...
the former Migration...
His language smacked of, you know, the Normandy invasion, really. It was one big secret...
Well, there was an amazing story for about 10 days, I think it was about in 2014. There was a suspected boat filled with, I think, about 157 Tamils moving towards Christmas Island. And he would not comment. He said, operations is on water matters. Mm. We do not comment. This went on about 10 days. And finally, it became a High Court challenge. And then, of course, he says, I can't talk about it because it's before the court. So this can easily be a way of not discussing issues, that it's operational. Mm. Does that create problems for you, Jacob, when you're trying to gather information, draw whistleblowers to the fold to discuss things?
I think certainly Australians have long accepted that there is room for government secrecy where the national security interest is involved. And almost all our laws will be even more protective about information of that ilk. So if it's intelligence information or military information. So certainly creating a sort of sense of military emergency around this certainly feeds into an acceptance that there might be some reasonable secrecy there. I think what happens though is that, you know, if we think about just the asylum seeker issue in a cost and benefit analysis sense, what we get is huge publicity over the benefits of the government's policy. You know, they'll say they've stopped the boats and whatever, there's been no deaths at sea. But all the costs are completely hidden and out of view. They're either shifted off to islands, either off the coast of Australia or foreign places altogether, where journalists can't get access, where there really isn't much media scrutiny at all, if any. And it's hard for lawyers to get involved and represent people. So I think what happens is the Australian people then are in this position where they're not able to make a proper assessment of whether this policy is working or not. They only see the benefits, which are broadcast very loudly, and
that
all
we've
the costs,
stopped the boats.
All the costs, yeah. which are very human costs of people living in detention for very long periods in which they don't know what's going to happen to them, of children really missing out on the ordinary development opportunities that children should have, possibly with lifelong consequences. These sorts of costs are what are hidden, and I think that's difficult for our clients politically, in the sense that they're invisible to the Australian people on the whole. But also, legally, it does create practical challenges because, you know, we're in the business of trying to put the best evidence in front of the court. And if we're restricted because people cannot tell us what they know on fear of being prosecuted, then that obviously means we're sort of in court fighting with one hand behind our back.
Well, how many watched Four Corners on Monday night? Not a huge amount. I suggest you do. It was a very fascinating forensic look at what, and a terrible, shocking story of what led to the death of a 24-year-old man, otherwise healthy young man on Manus Island, who got an infection that turned septic. And but what came out of that story, quite a few health professionals spoke out, even though they knew that they might attract the prosecution, because doctors have a specific role, Jacob, which you can discuss if you like. But one thing that I gained in that's relevant to tonight's conversation is from Professor David Isaacs, a paediatrician. He said, "Why haven't I been prosecuted? My feeling is that this legislation," and he's talking about the Border Force Act and the Crimes Act, "is not actually about imprisoning doctors, it's about silencing doctors and others." Mm. Would you agree with that?
I think so. I think the Save the Children example sort of demonstrates that, in that those people were, in effect, harassed by the AFP on the pretense that there was a potential crime committed. There was no actual prosecution that went ahead. As I said, there's very, very few prosecutions of breaches of those secrecy laws. And yet, it does put a sort of chill wind through anyone who would do so, would blow the whistle. If we talk about Soulette's example of the 1 in 10, there probably is, you know, 1 in 10 people who see the consequences in the real world and are brave enough to tell the world regardless of the consequences. But there might be another 2 or 3 who would like to say something but are concerned because they do have financial responsibilities or because they are afraid of spending time in jail, who because of that kind of level of harassment, intimidation and fear, won't say anything, even though there might be a very remote chance of any ill consequence coming to them. Just the fear of it might be enough to shut them up. I think that if we had less onerous secrecy laws, we would know a lot more from people on the ground about what has been going on.
And that's part of the reforms that are contained in this report, so I urge you to have a look at it. And I guess we all should mention that there are protections. Let's just very briefly, because time's going and I knew that we wouldn't get to half the subjects we'd like to talk about, but the Public Interest Disclosure Act, that was passed in 2013, that allows potential whistleblowers in the public interest. Can you just talk about how protective that is?
Sure. I mean, that is a very significant piece of legislation in terms of moving the conversation about whistleblowers forward in Australia. It's mostly practically effective in protecting people who make internal disclosures. So if someone has seen something, someone who works in DIBP, the Department of Immigration and Border Protection, complains to their boss about something, there are strong protections in that act against the boss for retaliating against that person. So that internal retaliation is prohibited, and hopefully that is allowing more space for internal information to disseminate up to the higher levels of government. What it has some protection for external disclosures, which is disclosures to the rest of the world.
Including the media?
Including media, but you do have to jump through quite a few hoops before you can access those exceptions. And in practice, there's always going to be a lingering doubt in the whistleblower's mind that they've successfully jumped through the hoops. And to do so, sometimes you're going to have to prove to a judge that the disclosure was in the public interest, that you had taken reasonable steps to disclose it internally first. So I think that practically there's still a problem there. I mean, I've advised lots of people who were potential whistleblowers, and I've had to say to them, this piece of legislation so far untested, we don't really know how it's going to work in practice, and there is some risk. And when the risk is 2 years in jail, that's a pretty significant risk.
And that's currently under review too. This particular act is under review.
But I think the recommendations in the report that Young Liberty have put together are very sensible, and I recommend reading the report. And I think the main change needs to be, it should be on the government to say that harm has been done by the disclosure, and that it was not in the public interest to disclose it, rather than putting the onus on the whistleblower.
It's the burden of proof is on the whistleblower.
It is. I mean, it gets a bit technical. The burden of proof, they've got to show that there's a reasonable argument, and then the burden can switch. But on the whole, the emphasis on the Crimes Act provision is still detached from any harm that's been done by the disclosure. And I think if you introduce that test and that concept, that will make a big difference.
For you, Roderick, being, you know, making that decision, What was the process? Did you go first internally? Did you say, look, I'm not happy with what's going on here? Because there were some terrible things that you witnessed and people... Did you go upwards first before you went to the media?
I went upwards a little bit.
Yeah.
But it was obvious from years of dealing with the company and that I was
there. Were you told to toughen up? Life's not a picnic? Because I've heard a few of whistleblowers have been told, come on, get real, this isn't a picnic for these guys, you know. We're showing that there's no advantage to coming by boat. And that's the whole policy.
Yeah, that was made crystal clear while we were on Manus working. I can't ever remember anyone saying that to me or any of the other officers there. But I spoke to my operations manager, and he was really nonplussed about it. He had a job to do. He was a tough cookie. I mean, he'd come out of the Sri Lankan army and, so in some respects he was in the wrong place to be looking after other Tamil refugees. But in many respects, I suppose, he was generally okay towards them, but he didn't have a lot of sympathy for the situation they were in. I knew enough about the company, and I suppose I've seen enough of life and worked enough in managerial positions to know how far those kinds of complaints will go. And it was very, very clear to me that the company had closely aligned itself with the department in terms of its operational criteria. So I wasn't going to get anywhere talking to anyone in my company. I did write one letter, and the only response was disappointed that you left after so short a period.
Now, you, part of your role, I mentioned earlier that you, in the introduction, that you were the OH&S manager, but you also had a couple of other roles which actually gave you entry to meetings with the department. And you've written a book about your experience at Manus, and you described these meetings as very awkward. What was going on there?
Yeah, as the risk assessment and intelligence manager,
what did that do? What was that?
Oh, it was really, it was a position that necessitated keeping an eye on the mood of the centre, taking the pulse, walking around and just gleaning information, finding out what was going on. And look, not everybody there, if the process was ever started to determine if they were legitimate refugees, we'd find out that not everyone there was a legitimate refugee. I mean, and I think statistically about 10% of those who apply aren't, right? So in this camp of 300, we could say...
And this included women and children at the stage where you...
Yeah, that's
when
true.
When you were there, it's only men now.
Right. So, we might say there were, 25, 30 who were clearly agitating, and you understood who they were. But they could have quite an effect on the mood of the camp. So that was part of what I had to determine and then go to these daily meetings. One of the biggest concerns for me and the other NGOs was the safety of vulnerable people, but the men in particular, a few youths there.
Found a young 19-year-old who'd been raped.
Correct.
By other inmates.
Yeah.
And there were some issues, I understand, of how that was dealt with between the department and your own work.
Yeah, right. I mean, the NGOs being the International Health and Medical Services, IHMS, Save the Children, Salvos, and myself, were really pushing for this young fellow to be taken off the island because there was no facility whatsoever for him to be to receive the proper treatment or to be kept safe. And the department made the point daily at meetings that he had to go back to the centre. And
their argument was that he would be better within his own cultural group or something, wasn't it?
Yeah, correct. I mean, it's the most inane thing I think I heard while I was there, that one of the departmental managers had read that people who suffer from rape will typically withdraw. But it's proven that the best therapy for them is to be back among the family. So this boy should really be put back among his family. And we said the people who raped him, they said, well, they're his cultural people. And so then the focus was put on me. Could you guarantee his safety? And I said, no, I couldn't.
And so there's more and more people like yourself who are witnessing these things and cannot stand by and just watch it. And so essentially, in the few minutes we've got left, what's your take-home message? What is your advice to potential whistleblowers? First, Jacob.
So my advice is there's a lot of talk about these secrecy provisions, and I don't want to get the message out there that you should be scared to blow the whistle. You should be careful about blowing the whistle. I think the first thing to do if you want to share your story about what you've seen is to speak to a lawyer. There are plenty of lawyers who are prepared to work pro bono on those kind of things, and a lawyer can probably help you steer a path through. The other option is to talk to a journalist. Journalists are covered by shield laws so that they can't be required to disclose who talked to them.
But although they can watch out for the metadata.
There can be risks in the way you communicate with the journalists that expose you. And you can also speak to a member of parliament. Although we also saw that the AFP was using footage from inside Parliament to see who was speaking to who inside the Parliament. So I'd say the best option is speak to a lawyer, and the lawyer could help you navigate which of those options are the best to get your information out there. One thing that the Public Interest Disclosure Act does provide is that seeking advice from a lawyer about the disclosure you wish to make is completely protected. And also normal rules of legal professional privilege apply.
Sulek?
So I'd say a couple of things. First, assess whether or not there is anyone in the organization you can turn to. It might not be your boss, might be someone else, to help address the wrongdoing. If that doesn't look like it's possible, then if you're going to go to the media, do it, in my view, anonymously, because it protects you and it protects them. And that means don't just set up a Gmail account named Fred Smith and send them an email, because you'll have your IP address attached to it potentially, or other things. Potentially the best way is either snail mail or face-to-face if you can corner them. And then don't carry on electronically unless you really know what you're doing. Be very careful about that. The other thing to consider is it's not just journalists. So there are, there are unions, and there are wonderful NGOs like Young Liberty for Law and other NGOs. And I think that the NGO area is evolving increasingly as an alternative for people to turn to who have serious wrongdoing, that they know about. And hopefully NGOs will be able to contribute to public debate by providing facts about these sort of instances.
And Roderick, this report from the Young Liberty Victoria has got a number of recommendations, and I urge you to have a look at them. Briefly, they include repealing that Section 70 of the Crimes Act, adding a further clause to allow protections of public interest for whistleblowers, and a lot of other recommendations. But I want to ask the panel, what are the most important reforms they'd like to highlight? That's maybe not just in the report, but for them personally. What about for you, Roderick? What would you like to see as a whistleblower, a person that's experienced this?
Look, I can be brief on that. I think that every responsible country, if they're going to take refugees, needs to have a screening process. I mean, that's just common sense. I just think that screening process should be humane, that it should be kind, That's it.
And I mean, so far, actually, there's been no.
Yeah.
Jacob, just in a couple of minutes we've got left. Despite more and more people coming out, saying what they see in detention centres and processing centres, Christmas Island as well, not just doctors but guards, other workers, there's yet to be any legal repercussions, has there, in the courts yet? We can take heart from this, can we?
Perhaps we can. I mean, I wouldn't want to be the first person who took heart from that and then ended up in jail.
But if Sulet's right and Australian public absolutely supports whistleblowers, we'd find the public, you guys, rising up, wouldn't we? Perhaps.
Can I just say something? When I spoke to Julian Burnside last week about some of the things that might be discussed here and what I could say as a whistleblower, he reminded me of something that he told me when the review was done into the allegations I made.
This is the Robert Cornell review.
Yeah, it was an independent review held at immigration offices, organised by immigration officials with immigration secretary there, but it was independent. And I called him to ask some questions, and the first thing he said, well, he answered my question, he said, don't let them bully you. And if they threaten you, I want you to know that I will head up the largest team of pro bono lawyers the country has ever seen to fight for you. And when I saw him last week, he reminded me of it and he said, I want you to say that. All right, so I'm saying that as...
not just Julian Birdsoe, but all yeah. things. I'd like to just finish now because there's 40 seconds left and I'd like to open up for questions. I just found this little quote because I was very intrigued that last week the Pulitzer Prize for Photography went to New York Times photographer of refugees on the sea. And it just made me, I thought, we would never, our, you know, equivalent Walkley Award for photographs, a photographer would never be able to actually take those photos in order to get a Walkley Award for photography. And it just occurred to me how that, in a sense, encapsulates the secrecy and misunderstanding. And then I thought, oh, I'll look up, Pulitzer. I'd forgotten who he was. And I found this amazing quote. And he says, Joseph Pulitzer was a journalist, Columbian University, and that Pulitzer Prize was started up. He says, there is not a crime, there is not a dodge, there is not a trick, there is not a swindle, there is not a vice which does not live by secrecy. And I thought that was kind of apt, that secrecy is a wall for democracy. Any questions for our audience? Yes. And I think there's a microphone. Yes.
Thanks very much. Thanks, Anita, and thank you very much to the panellists for that great discussion. I'm one of the co-authors of the report, and our report finds that there are extensive practical, cultural and legal barriers to people speaking out, and also that there's currently a culture of secrecy, particularly in relation to offshore detention centres. And perhaps, Anita, following on from your last question, I'd like to ask the panellists what risks this culture of secrecy creates for our democracy.
Do you want to go first?
It goes back to your gauge, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Your gauge, talks about the temperature.
The problem with secrecy is it makes it really easy for wrongdoing to happen. And not only to happen, but to happen writ large, So it becomes something that feeds on itself. And in fact, it's the PETA Act that was passed here in Australia has been a double-edged sword in that it's a wonderful advancement, a significant step forward. In fact, in a study of G20 country laws on whistleblowing that I've co-authored, Australia is you know ranked in the top one. It is the top one in public sector for the area that it covers. But we also know that the secrecy provisions in it that exclude effectively intelligence and law enforcement kind of say, well, our obligations in some of those things assume that no wrongdoing ever happens in those organizations or entities. And of course, it does. So it's very important to maintain the right ethical temperature in a society to have as much transparency as you can have of powerful institutions. There's a role for personal privacy, and in a way, the less powerful you are in a society, the more important your personal privacy is. But for large and powerful institutions, there has to be transparency, so there's accountability.
But I guess, too, following on from that, I think essentially you're dealing with vulnerable people, so there has to be some kind of balance between protecting these vulnerable people in our care, in Australia's care, and...
So there is, but I think one of the things that is really concerning is how often a bureaucracy will say, oh, can't discuss that case for privacy reasons of the people involved, when a lot of the people involved would be very happy to allow their private information to be discussed if only they were not kept in prison in an environment where, you know, their personal, physical, and psychological safety was at risk. So, you know, it's quite easy to hide behind elements of this and, in a sense, misuse privacy provisions in order to effectively get institutional secrecy.
Is there a... Ah, right up there in the middle. There, I think
Yes. Considering that the levels of support for whistleblowers are so high and have been for such a long time, why has it taken such a long time for a reform to happen to say that if you're disclosing a crime that occurred, there's no way you should be punished at all, and there should be no threat of punishment?
But there's thresholds. Jacob, could you? Yeah.
So that's probably the expert in those.
Yeah. Well, one of the biggest problems, and in fact, it's very interesting. The Young Liberty for Law report is very timely because I've co-authored a report that's coming out on May 9th. Looking at the UK PETA laws, and so many of the things that they have brought forward in this report are echoed in that. And one of the most important elements is what protections are there to stop reprisals before they happen. Now, we look around and go, oh, how can you do that? But actually, Bosnia has a law that does that. Bosnia, you say? Yes, Bosnia and Herzegovina. They've actually brought in parts of a whistleblowing law. It's not perfect, but it has an element that allows people who work in government to effectively go and get a certificate of whistleblower protection that prevents them from being sacked, prevents reprisal rather than trying to remedy it after the fact. And that's really important. And in fact, even though it's new, it's starting to work. So, you know, my research is they've already had a couple of cases. People have been reinstated who've revealed corruption in the tax office and in other things. And so it can be done. But you've actually got to get into the process earlier. And that's partially the evolution of research into whistleblowing and what protections need to be put in place.
Hmm. Yes, up there.
Thank you. I gave evidence against government at a state parliamentary inquiry in 2008, which led later to a range of tactics that cost me my health, wealth, damaged my reputation, and it's taken 2.5 years to recover. My experience led me to approach Whistleblowers Australia. They said in 20 years they haven't dealt with a whistleblower who hasn't lost health, wealth, reputation, career opportunities. They also said the focus seems to be more about the suppression of dissent and is often about the power of vested interests behind government. Roderick, what's been your experience in terms of health, wealth, career opportunities and reputation? And the other panel members, how do you encourage whistleblowing when suppression of dissent seems to be a big driver by government?
Very good question and very powerful.
Well, firstly, good on you for doing what you did. Look, there's been great personal cost to me. I'd be lying if I didn't say that I still think of Annis daily. I'm probably over the cold sweats now. I still have nightmares. You know, all the kinds of things that you could imagine PTSD delivering, you know. I had them and plus some. I still see some professional counsellors and they're coming up with new, asking me questions. I give them an answer and they say that's another symptom. You know, for someone who was fairly well balanced, you know, for most of my, or okay, my wife might deny that, but I thought I was well balanced for up until I was about 52, and yeah, it's done a number on me. Yeah, definitely. It probably hasn't hurt me as much financially, I'm just in a position where regular work isn't necessary at the moment, which is probably a good thing because, you know, I'm sure as a teacher I'd be a pariah to some schools. And although I was approached immediately after the Dateline episode by several schools to teach on...
Roderick told his story to Dateline and that was a very powerful story. And Jacob, actually, I understand there's quite a few legal cases, not just in your company, but your firm, but other firms, of former workers in detention centre who are suing for compensation for these very issues, for PTSD, anxiety.
I mean, I think in answer to your question, there's two parts. One is that there are various protections that can make sure that the damage that you suffer as a whistleblower is limited or mitigated or compensated, but they're probably never going to be okay to put you back in the position where you were. Mm. It's worth getting advice, you know, beforehand or after you've blown the whistle about what your rights are in that regard. I think the other thing to remember, though, is that whistleblowers do make a massive difference, and they've made a massive difference in the asylum seeker debate because despite the secrecy, there has been information that has gotten out. And when the public mood has changed, it's been on the basis of real stories about the kind of abuse and mistreatment that people have received in detention. So, you know, Anita introduced me by talking about the over 100 kids we represented and got out of detention. That wasn't because, in the end, we won in court. We lost in court. But we kept the children here long enough that because of the work of whistleblowers and because of the work of other organisations that were trying to raise awareness about the conditions on Nauru and conditions asylum seekers are facing across the board, there was a change in the political mood and Clive Palmer and Ricky Muir secured a deal to let our kids out. And that was because of whistleblowers. So if there is something that you can put on the other side of the ledger, you suffer some personal cost, we can do what we can to mitigate that, but it's definitely going to be hard for you. Hopefully, what you do is good for so many other people that can give you some solace. And certainly all the whistleblowers in the asylum seeker space have done that.
And I suppose that recently with baby Asher, that was a kind of another thing that tested the pulse of the public's willingness to come out and speak out against these sorts of issues. Soulette, have you got a comment?
I think the main thing to consider is that, you know, where once some time ago people would have considered whistleblowers as breaking an oath to their organization, allegiance to their organization, and maybe they do have to do that. But there are times and places to do that, and you don't do it lightly. In fact, it's very interesting. I've interviewed a number of people in former law enforcement and national security about why they would blow the whistle. And they describe a scenario where, you know, this is their life, their soul. It's not like they can just pick up another job at the company down the street. There are no alternatives. It's their identity. So for them to blow the whistle on something is an enormous wall to crawl over. It's huge for them. But sometimes you see something that is so terrible that you just, as a human, have to speak out. Mm. And that need to dissent, in a sense, this evolving human right of the right to dissent from wrongdoing supersedes any work contracts or allegiances to organizations. And I think the good part is that as a society, we're starting to both recognize it and support
and
it.
And applaud it,
yeah,
yes.
And support it, that's right.
I should just add too, I spoke to Tony Burke in the wake of my allegations, and within weeks he had taken all 300 off Manus, brought them to the mainland and released about 150 children from Pontville. I don't know that he would have done that if I hadn't spoken to him personally. I'm not saying it was the weight of my words, it was just the fact that no one had told him. No one told him how bad it was. And I believe that Mark Davis was convinced that he was simply ignorant. And that's not uncommon. Most people at the top don't know what's going on at ground level.
Oh, sadly, we have to sort of wrap it up, and I'm sure there's lots in here we can discuss, and I hope you all read the report and think about it. I'd really like to thank this wonderful panel, Sulette Dreyfus, Jacob Varghese and Roderick St. George. Thank you so much.
Visit WheelerCentre.com for the best in books, writing and ideas from Melbourne, Australia and the world.